I'm Reverend Rick, and it is my honor to be with you today. We really hope that this video is a blessing to you. And if it is, please consider making a donation. People watch our videos locally when they cannot necessarily come to church throughout the United States and the world. So please join us and click the link below and make a donation. Thank you, and let this be a blessing to you.
Put your hand over your eyes. I open my eyes to see the spiritual truth today. Now over your ears, I open my ears to hear the spiritual truth today. And now over your heart, just extend out your arms. I open my heart to receive the spiritual truth today. The spiritual truth that I'm working with today is that you are powerful beyond measure. You are powerful beyond measure. Now, the reason that I say that with such conviction is because you can't measure God. And the presence of God is who you are. You are simply a representation of God, of spirit, of Allah, of Elohim on this planet. And you cannot measure God. Now, maybe there are some people who are joining us today because we have a lot of visitors, and you might be thinking, what is she? Is she saying that we're God? Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, that's exactly what I'm saying. Now, the truth is that we can't be all of God because we can't even wrap our head around how big God is. But God is all of us. And if we can begin to understand that and walk in that framework, not in the controlling God of your childhood, not in the sometimey God of our childhood, but in the God of love, if we can begin to walk with infinite wisdom and divine love, this planet would spin in a whole different way than it is right now. You have the power that is unleashed, that can be unleashed in you to live harmoniously every single day of the week with a person that's working your very last breath. You have the power within you to live abundantly right now, even though your bank account is zero. You have the power within you right now to create the dream job you want, even if that job that you're going to every day is not your dream job. That's the kind of power you have. And the good news is you don't need to do anything in order to get that power. It's your divine inheritance. Our spiritual work is not to get the power. The spiritual work we have before us is to stop the leak of the power that is inside of us going outside of us in our life. See, it's to stop making things outside of us more important than things are, and more powerful than things are inside of us in our life. And we've all done it. We've given our power to our lovers, we've given our power to our bosses, we've given power to addictive substances, we've given power to religious doctrines, we've given power to the news. I give power to the news all the time. It just saps my power. It's my choice to do that. I have the power. My work is to stop the leaks. Hey, here's a little bonus this morning. If when you look in the mirror and you see anything other than a casing for spirit, you've allowed yourself to be susceptible to the lies and the illusions of this society, that you're not enough. And those lies and illusions, if you agree with them, you have to agree with them, but if you agree with those lies and illusions, that power will just begin to leak right out of those holes. Maybe somebody told you you weren't smart. That's a lie. Maybe somebody told you you weren't compassionate. That's a lie. Maybe somebody told you you weren't handsome or pretty. That's a lie. Maybe somebody told you you weren't responsible with money. That's a lie. All of those things, if we believe in them, will sap the power right out of us and make us live small lives. We weren't sent here to live lives being small and mincing around and apologizing for our lives. No, we were sent here to live life out loud, to be the presence of God on the planet out loud in this life, not to get by. Here's some help. Anytime any experience leaves you feeling empty or less than or needy, does so for only one reason. You entered into that experience feeling less than or needy or empty in your life. It's not about what's out there. It's about what's inside. See, our work is only to change what's inside of us. And when we change what's inside of us, you'd be surprised at how the outside starts to change. You start respecting yourself, I'm going to tell you, you'll be surprised at how many people start respecting you. Not because you demanded it, not because you told them to, but because you started respecting yourself. And that began to flow outside. Well, this week, I was working with cleaning out my bookshelf, and I happened to pick up a book, one of lesser-known books by Napoleon Hill. Napoleon Hill, many of you know, wrote Think and Get Rich, and he wrote Think and Get Rich. He's actually one of America's premier leak stoppers, this Napoleon Hill is. And his most famous book was Think and Grow Rich, and he wrote that book after a challenge by Andrew Carnegie. Andrew Carnegie told him, look, if you will go out and interview the 500 most influential people on the planet and then write a simple formula for success, it will be a bestseller. And that's exactly what he did. He interviewed 500 people who were successful. Now, they weren't successful immediately. Many of them were grand failures before they became successful. But they became successful. He wrote about it. He developed this formula, which is what is Think and Grow Rich. Now, this book that I'm talking about is one of his lesser-known works, and it's called Anyone Can Perform a Miracle. Anyone can perform a miracle as long as they have a positive mental attitude. As long as they have a positive mental attitude. Developing a positive mental attitude takes effort, it takes commitment, and it takes faith. That's what goes into a positive mental attitude: effort, commitment, and faith. It doesn't take money. It doesn't take a hot body. It doesn't take living in a prestigious area. It doesn't take a PhD from a prestigious university. It takes commitment, effort, and faith. That's what it takes. Hill, in this book, he says, look, there are four enemies of mankind that we fall victim to without a fight. I thought it was so interesting. Four enemies of mankind that we fall victim to without a fight. It just resonated with me. Because sometimes we just accept stuff. You know, people tell you you're clumsy long enough, you start believing you don't fight it anymore. You just start believing it and being more and more clumsy in any area of your life. The four enemies that he talks about are fear, superstition, ignorance, and poverty. I want to add a fifth, and that is doctor diagnosis. Because a lot of times we get these diagnoses and we fall victim to them without a fight. But it's true in any of those other four areas. Most doctors will admit, my doctor's in the house this morning, and she will always admit that our mental attitude is far superior to anything they can lay out on the table. Any protocols, any modalities, any medicines, any operations, that medicine now admits that medical attitude is far more important in healing than any of those other things in our life. You know, it's not only in our health, but in every area, in our financial area, in our dating area, in every area of our life, our mental attitude is far more important. You know, even golf coaches have stopped working first on swing, and they start now working first on mental attitude. And once they get your mental attitude organized, then they go to the swing. Mental attitude. Positive mental attitude is a secret to making miracles in our life. Well, there's now scientific evidence to support what Napoleon Hill wrote, what Ernest Holmes wrote, same thing. What Jesus of Nazareth said, same thing. There's now scientific evidence to look at that. Many of you are familiar with the work of Masaru Emoto. Emoto was a Japanese artist. He was a scientist. He was a prolific writer. And he got hooked on studying how consciousness affects water, how human consciousness affects water. And I was reminded of this the other day when one of our board members, Ami Barnes, said that she saw a little video that had an impact on helping people understand how powerful this idea of consciousness on water is. Now let me tell you how Emoto got involved in this. In the 1950s, there was a group of scientists that were developing biological weapons of mass destruction in a country that I will not name. But they sat around and they were working on developing these biological weapons of mass destruction. And one afternoon, they were really at it. They were around their conference table and they were really going at this discussion. And all of them got sick that evening, every single one of them. So they thought it was food poisoning. So they tested them. First of all, they asked them what they ate, and they said, we didn't eat anything since lunch. We just had water. And so they tested them, and there was no sign of food poisoning. And so they went and they tested the water. And they thought it must have been in the water. It must have been tampered with. It must have been contaminated. Well, the water was contaminated. It was toxic. By the consciousness of those men who are around the table creating biological weapons. That mean-spirited thinking contaminated that water, and it made him sick. And from there, Emoto went on to study much more. That was in the 1950s. Emoto went on to study how consciousness influences water and what that might mean for us. So I found the little video Ami was talking about, and Steve, can we watch that now? It's just about a 3-minute video. Thank you. walking yourself down, think of this. Think of the holes that it's drilling into you. Now, I want to keep talking about the power of positive attitude, but I want to make sure that we're not beating ourselves up with this information. I want to make sure that we're not shaming ourselves because, oh my God, I have this or that. I have a bad job because I have a bad consciousness. Don't even go there. Don't even go there, because that's not what we're talking about today. If you have a scary diagnosis, if you have a job or a marriage that's at risk, if you are a person of color today who has just run into your 10th well-meaning racist person, if you are part of the LGBTQ community and you just opened your Facebook and you found you have a relative that has really mean-spirited thoughts about who you are, if you're a white male and you're just, you know, not wanting to take on everybody's bad behavior anymore, any of those things that are happening, go ahead and give yourself a little time to get mad. So you get mad. It's okay. Because it's important for us to know that if we're having a feeling, our job is not to stuff it down. The job is not to put a little pasty smile over everything and think everything is fine in this lifetime. But here it is. We want to give ourselves some time to get mad, but we want to put some time limit on how we have a negative attitude in our life. So find, if you're mad, you're angry, give yourself some time. And if you're having trouble getting out of it, contact a practitioner, contact a best friend, contact somebody who can help you get out of it in your life. See, because we want you to have this experience when you're angry to have it, so that you can do what it's necessary to get rid of it, to cry, to get mad, to throw things, to shake, to say what some people call bad words. Whatever it is that you need to do, we need to do it, because your anger is purposeful as long as it's not turned inward. Because the minute that anger is turned inward, you're not doing anybody any good, and you're just causing yourself some heart troubles. See, people got mad at Stonewall. Stonewall happened because people got mad and they got scared. Black Lives Matter happens because people are mad and they're scared. Parkland High School has turned up the volume on gun control because they're mad and they're scared. It's purposeful. As long as we take it to the streets, as long as we take it out, not in. I'm frankly mad as hell at what's happening in this country. I'm mad as hell at what's happening to those children in Brownsville, Texas. I am mad as hell. I'm mad as hell at what's happening to some of our beautiful environmental areas because protections are going away. I'm mad as hell at what's happening to public school under this new direction. I am mad as hell, and I'm going to take it to the streets. In November, I will be in that voting booth. Amen. And I hope all of you are. I'm not going to tell you how to vote, but vote your conscience, vote your values. And our values is to empower people, to uplift people, not to make them smaller because of money in our lives. So don't fear your negative attitudes. Embrace them. Put a time limit on there. You know, the other day I was practicing with this and I just got irked at one of my neighbors. And irked is my Sunday word. And so finally I said to myself, okay, I'm going to have funky thoughts about this neighbor. I'm going to be mad about this neighbor until 3 o'clock. And if at 3 o'clock I haven't shifted this, I'm going to call my practitioner. And I'm going to get some help. Or I'm going to talk to Don. Or I'm going to talk to somebody. And I'm going to get some help because it's a choice. Anger after that, after expressed, is a choice in our life. And here's what we don't understand. See, sometimes that we think when we're having a negative attitude, we're pushing our good away. That's really not the case. When we have a negative attitude, we're drawing what we don't want closer to us. We're bringing it into our lives. So our work is to begin to work on this developing a habit. See, negative attitudes might bring you sympathy, but they won't bring you success. It might make you understood, but they won't bring you success. So you have to ask yourself, is it more important for me to have sympathy? Is it more important for me to be understood? Or is it more important for me to have success? And you know what? There's no wrong answer. The wrong answer is if you let the understood and the sympathy go too long, and then you become a victim, and you lose the power. It leaks out of you in your life. A positive attitude is the habit of keeping your mind busily engaged in feeling what you want, not what you don't want. It's the habit of keeping your mind busily engaged. You control your mind. Keep it busily engaged in the things you want, not the things that you don't want to happen. And you know, when we get hurt by somebody, we get mad at somebody, don't we just put it on a loop? It just goes on a loop. And it just keeps going in and going in and going in and going in. It's our choice to stop the loop. We have the power to stop that loop in our life. See, because your mind can't hold opposing thoughts. It can't hold positive thoughts and negative thoughts at the same time. So you're going to have to change. Sometimes it's like watching a tennis match, you know? My kids are driving me crazy. Oh, they're so cute. But they leave everything all over. But they're so nice. It's when you get to a longer point of your tennis match that you're doing all the serving with your positive mind, that's when things begin to shift. So I'm going to talk a little bit about three or four things we can do practically to develop this positive mind of ours. Because remember, the point of the positive mind is you can make a miracle happen. You can make a miracle happen. So number one, remind yourself that it's better to spend 10 minutes thinking about what's good than what you don't want. Remind yourself of that. The second thing is let go of the association with the awfulizers. Choose to be around people who support you, who want your success. And the awfulizers, just let go. The people, oh, ain't it awful? It's so bad. Everything's bad. Stay away from them for a while. Love them. Don't hate them. Love them. But stay away from them if you can. The third one is have affirmations. Develop affirmations, one-sentence affirmations that just simply affirm what it is that you want. And don't worry about how you're going to get it. Just affirm what it is that you want. You know, people come to my office and they say, Reverend George, I got a problem. It's okay. I listened to the problem and I said, okay, now we're going to make an affirmation. No, Reverend Georgia, no. I need you. This is a big problem. I need your big guns. These little affirmations, they're not. Look, those affirmations are the biggest guns I got in my chest. All right? The last one I want to just mention is spend a few minutes every night thinking of just five things to be grateful for. Every night, five things to be grateful for. And try and make them the last thing you think about before you go to sleep so it can begin to work on your consciousness and your subconscious as you're sleeping. Because you have the power. You have the power. And don't forget, God, that's great. How many people here are still on day one? Yeah, me too after yesterday. I'm two today, but. Let's take this message. Knowing there is a power for good in the universe. It's a power for love. I just let it run through me. Let it take over. So that my small thoughts of protection and judgment are gone. They just dissipate. I give thanks. I release this word in the law together we say. And so.